Al Jazeera's Mahmoud Abdulwahid has more now from Baghdad.
The Security Council of Iraq's northern semi-autonomous Kurdish region has announced that at 11:30 p.m. January 15th, the Iran's Revolutionary Guard fired ballistic missiles and targeted civilian areas in the Iraq's northern city of Erbil.
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Hey, so if you don't know, so this is Bassem. By the way, my class, you're going to be here in the end of March, and so the class will meet you. But in the meantime, I'm going to have them watch a video of your story about you, so you know they know who you are.
And so, with a very complex range of emotions, of joy, and friendship, and deep sadness, and deep grief. And I wish I wasn't doing what I'm about to do, because it would mean none of this ever happened. I want to introduce you to my friend, Bassem.
But you're in Erbil, and...
I'm in Mosul, actually. I left Erbil this morning.
Oh, you're in Mosul. Okay. In Iraq. So, hey, yeah. So what happened? What happened outside of Erbil?
Yeah, I was watching some news around 12:30 in the morning last night, when the first really huge explosion was heard, and followed by 11 really, really big explosions. And then I opened the window to my bedroom and I could hear sirens and talk in English, so I knew one of the bombs was probably near the consulate, the American consulate. And then it was in the news that four missiles had hit a businessman in Erbil. He died with his 1-year-old son. His wife is badly injured. And an hour later, the Iranian Revolutionary Guard claimed responsibility for the bombing. Yeah.
Man, it's so... Wow, man. It just really makes me nervous about what we're seeing here. Yeah. How about you? How are people in Iraq? How are your friends? And
well, I left around 11 a.m. coming to Mosul, and the entrance to the airport was closed. And it seems that I did not hear it in the morning that three more drones had hit Erbil airport, or attempted to hit, but they were shut down before they reached the airport. So, like, I think 10 days ago, there was a huge bombing in Iran, and on the anniversary of Soleimani bombing in Baghdad. And it seems the Iranians blame Israelis, and they said Israel had a foothold in Erbil, and we bombed that house because there was some meeting for Israelis or something like this.
Yeah, which doesn't seem like that doesn't seem likely.
No.
Yeah, no. Yeah, it doesn't. So, are people feeling in Iraq feeling really nervous about this?
Well, people in Erbil, we're really nervous because I went around one outside, and I live in a 13-story apartment building, and everybody was down in the parking lots. They were afraid to go back to their apartments because the American consulate is about 3 miles from where I live, and the sound was really, really strong. And I'm sure people living in higher floors felt it more than I did, because I live on the ground floor.
Man.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really, it's unsettling. There's a lot. Yeah, there's a lot going on, man. We are in the middle of some really troubling unease, I will say. Unease and unrest. Yeah. Everywhere. Yeah. Everywhere. It's not just, it's everywhere, man.
It's everywhere, but the whole region is on a verge of explosion. I'm really afraid of that.
Yeah. So for you, that also must be really just bring, like, it's traumatizing, right, for you? I mean,
you know, when I was watching the news this morning again, when I learned of this guy was really his businessman, and he lives between Dubai and London, and he just came to Erbil last week, and he died in Erbil, young, probably in his 50s.
Wow.
A really good businessman, and he got killed. His wife is badly injured. His son is badly injured. His 1-year-old daughter died with him. And he had one guy from the Philippines who worked for him also died. Crazy, crazy. I felt what happened because I went through it. And a funny thing, just before I heard the news about this guy dying and his wife was badly injured, funny enough, she's suffering from broken hip, just like what I suffered from after my bombing.
Lori and I were in a hotel in St. Louis on the day of the wedding of a friend of ours, and we get this message on Facebook. I see it on Facebook, and it says, Bassem is sad. And I say, Bassem is sad? Huh, that's interesting. And then I see some responses, and they have sad faces. And so I start translating it. And then I say, oh, no, that can't be possible. So I translate it again. And I say, no, that's not possible. I try a different translator, and I translate. And here's what it says. In the middle of the night, coalition airplanes targeted two houses occupied by innocent civilians. This barbarian attack cost the lives of my wife, my daughter, my brother, and my nephew. May they rest in peace, and may Allah Almighty accept them as martyrs. Is this American technology? Is this American technology? And by martyrs, he meant any Muslim, any innocent Muslim who dies.
And yesterday, there was a question on Facebook. What year would you like to take out of your life? And right away, I said 2015, because that was the worst year for me and my family.
Mm-hmm.
So I sympathize with the injured because I've been there.
So the coalition forces got the wrong coordinates for what they thought was an ISIS bomb making building.
Yeah.
And it was Bassem's home and his brother's home. And they were both two direct hits with smart bombs, and they destroyed the entire. Yeah. And Bassem's wife, Miata, died, his daughter died, Tuka, and his brother Mohammed, and your nephew.
Yeah.
And Bassem is still living in the living with us. So when he talks about the trauma, so it's really, that's pretty intense that gentleman had such an experience. Yeah, that's pretty intense. You know, Bassem, when I read these stories, right, like that, they touch. They touch me because I touch you and you touch me. You know what I mean? It's like, it's not, these aren't just people, these are human beings, you know?
Yeah. When I heard that this guy, he came from London last Saturday and he died the next day, you know, the day after. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't live in Erbil. He lives between Dubai and London. And he came to Erbil to die. I mean, this is devastating. I mean,
yeah. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Well, I hope things settle, calm down. I hope they just don't take off, man. We don't need this. We don't need more death.
We don't need it. No, yeah. We don't. No, we don't. No.
Yeah. Okay. Hey. All right, man. Are you? You're at your mom's house.
Yeah, in my mom's house. Yeah,
in the kitchen.
In the kitchen. You've been here.
we're all the magic happens.
Yeah, sitting on the table you had dinner on.
My wife and I So if you don't know, my wife and I went to Iraq to visit Bassem, and the most dangerous person we met, people say, oh, you know, was it safe? Were you nervous? Were you whatever? And I'm like, well, listen, the most dangerous person I met in Iraq was Bassem's mom, because she gave us so much food to eat and demanded that we eat it. And the food was so good. I swear I could still be there eating it. Yeah, I couldn't even move when I was done. I don't think I had ever eaten that much food.
You know, yesterday I was buying her some chocolate, dark chocolate, and I remember the chocolate you brought her. And yesterday I was just thinking about you just drinking the chocolate.
Yeah. All right. Well, when you're visiting in March, April, we'll send you back.
So. Thank you so much.
All right, give her my greetings, please.
I will. All right, we'll talk. Okay, take care. Bye-bye.